بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين
بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. Reading the chapter of حكم سجود السهو, the ruling of making سجود السهو. We previously explained what it means, its importance, some of its wisdoms and secrets, and now we're continuing our discussion on the actual ruling. Do you have to make sujood as-sahu, or is it just preferable, recommended? Is it something that you must do? If you make a mistake, if you forget in your salah, and you leave the salah without fixing it in a proper, legislated manner, are you getting a sin or not? Are you getting a sin or not? So therefore, the author, so far he mentioned three hadiths. All three of them are in Bukhari and Muslim. The first was narrated by Abdullah ibn Buhayna, the second of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and the third of Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Then we reached the fourth hadith, which is also narrated by Abu Huraira. And we said, Umar, that the fourth hadith is the fork in the road. The first three hadith here, hikayatu fi'lin min an-nabi alayhi as-salatu was-salam. Wal hadith ar-rabi'u huwa qawlun sarih, amrun sarih. Fayakhtalif, the way that we are going to look at the fourth hadith than the first three hadiths. The first hadith proves and teach us is that the Prophet ﷺ forgot in the salah. He forgot, alayhi salatu wasalam. And he did something when he forgot. He made sujood as-sahu. He fixed the mistake, the error. However, the fourth hadith teaches us that the Prophet ﷺ is speaking to us. He's talking to us. He's addressing us. It has when one of you forgets, fal yasjud. That's amr. Wal amru yufid al-wujub. Everybody understand this? So this fourth hadith we explained last week is from the strongest of evidences to prove that sujood as-sahu is wajib, it's fard, it's mandatory, and it is not preferable, it is not optional. Everybody clear on this? So we have four hadiths, all authentic, from the Prophet ﷺ teaching us about sujood as-sahu. As we said last week, and we'll say again, if someone has a madhab, if someone has an issue, if someone says, I'm a layman Muslim, I don't understand much, knowledge is confusing, Islam is confusing, fiqh is confusing, there's so many scholars, so many speakers, etc., so on and so forth. We say that no Muslim is going to misunderstand these first four hadiths. From the deen is sujood as-sahu. So if there's a madhab or a fatwa says no sujood as-sahu, you shouldn't make sujood as-sahu. That's something that you don't have to do, you shouldn't do in a salah. The general layman Muslim can clearly benefit that what? Or if it's not obligatory, at least it's from the what? No doubt about that. And you don't need Malik, Shafi, Ahmed, or Abu Hanifa to understand that. Mm-hmm. I understand that. Some things are clear, and every layman Muslim can benefit therefrom, let alone a talib al-ilm. Everybody got this? Everybody understand this? And this is a very important principle for us all to understand, because this is one of the doubts that the people they have when it comes to these different pieces of fanaticism that they have. The ta'assub for the madhahib. They say these ulama were greater than us. They live, they walk the earth. They know better. They've researched everything. It's nothing less for you to research, Adam. It's nothing that you're going to come across that those ulama for over 1400 years didn't come across. What's the point of you reading Sahih Bukhari? What's the point of you reading the books of Hadith, reading the books of the Sunnah? Just follow. It's been laid down for you. Everybody understand this? Khayran, inshallah. The fifth hadith, the author, he says, عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا شك أحدكم في صلاته فلم يدري كم صلى ثلاثا أم أربعة فليطرح الشك وليبني على المستيقن ثم يسجد سجدتين قبل أن يسلم فإن كان صلى خمسا شفعنا له صلاته وإن كان صلى إتماما لأربع كانتا ترغيما للشيطان. Says here, narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri رضي الله عنه, the Messenger of Allah عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, إذا شك أحدكم في صلاته, when someone has doubt, they have shak, they're unsure about the prayer that they offered. فَلَمْ يَدْرِي كَمْ صَلَّى. I don't know how many raka'ah I made. ثَلَاثًا أَمْ أَرْبَعًا. Three or four.
We previously mentioned the reasons behind sujood as-Sahu are three. Three reasons: doing something more, doing something less, or having doubt, being unsure. So the hadith says, when one of you has shak, he has doubt about something that he did in a salah, he doesn't know how many rak'at he made, three or four, the following things should be done. Number one, فَلْيَطْرَحِ الشَّكْ. The Prophet ﷺ says, abandon the doubt. Leave the doubt. Do away with the doubt. Ignore the doubt. That's step number one. فَلْيَطْرَحِ الشَّكْ. Number two, وَلْيَبْنِي عَلَى مَسْتَيْقًا. He says, and you should fix your prayer, correct your prayer, based upon that which you're sure. Based upon that which you're sure of. I know that I made three rak'ah. Not sure about the fourth, but I'm sure about three. So step number one is to ignore the voice in your head. It's gone. And to make your yaqeen that I made how many rak'at? Three. Even though it's quite possible that you made four. But you're sure about how much? Three. The smaller number you're definitely what? Sure of. There's no doubt about that. I'm positive about that. Three rak'at I made. It may be four, perhaps. But I'm not sure. But I know definitely that I made at least what? Three. I mean three, not four. Only three. Only three. Fourth is doubt. So the process is فَلْيَطْرَحِ الشَّكْ. Don't leave off the doubt. وَلْيَبْنِي عَلَى مَسْتَيْقًا. And build upon your yaqeen, that which you are certain. The hadith then teaches us, ثُمَّ يَسْجُدُ سَجْدَتَيْنِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يُسَلِّمْ. Then he should make two sajdas before the taslim. Before the taslim. Now we previously explained that sujood as-Sahu or sajdat as-Sahu is much more than just two positions. We said it's how many positions? No, not four. How many positions is it? We said five. First position is sujood, then jilsa, then sujood, then jilsa, then taslim. Everybody got that? So sajdat as-Sahu is much more than just two what? Everybody clear on this? It's much more than just two sujood. You give a poor person a bag of rice. That's sadaqah. You've paid your kafara, your atonement. You gave him rice. But he can't cook the rice without water, fire, pot, etc. So these are necessary pieces to enjoy the rice. So in order to make the sajda, you have to do things before and after. So it's much more than just two. It's five things. But the title, the laqab is just what? Two. Everybody got this? Everybody understand this or not? You give a poor person some meat from your slaughtered animal. You give sadaqah, some meat. Some people may eat raw meat or some types of raw meat, but in general, he has to do what? Just cook the meat. He needs some type of fire, some type of pan, some type of grill, some type of spit. Something to prepare the meat with. Everybody understand this? So the poor person says, you gave me rice and meat, but I don't have no gas in my house. I don't have no electricity in my house. I can't eat it. So the sajda tasahu is much more than just what? Two, as we explained last week. The author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he then says, فَإِنْ كَانَ صَلَّ خَمْسًا شَفَعْنَا لَهُ صَلَاتَهُ. He says, if the person actually made four rak'ah, and he made an additional fifth, he says, then that extra rak'ah will make his salah shafa. It will make it what? Even. It will make his salah what? Even. In other words, he made how many rak'at? No. No. La. Five is an odd or even number.
Three.
Okay. How many rak'at did this man make based off of this one hadith? How many?
Four.
We don't know. That's false. We don't know. We don't know how many rak'at he made. How many rak'at did he make? For sure, how many?
Three.
Three, there you go. We know. You think four, but you know? Ayo, for sure. So then what did the man do? فَلْيَطْرَحَ الشَّكْ وَلْيَسْتَبْنِي. He says, وَلْيَبْنِي عَلَى مَسْتَيْقًا. He says, number one, leave off the doubt, and then build upon that which is what?
Sure.
So it's possible that he made?
Four.
He knows for sure that he made?
Three.
Everybody got this? So therefore, let's say that he did make four rak'at. He performed the extra rak'ah, which was what? How many now?
Five.
When he built upon the yaqeen, how many did he actually make?
Four.
No. But once again, start from the beginning. He's sure of how many?
Three.
Good. All right. But let's say in actuality, he actually did what? He really made four. But he's only sure of?
Three.
Everybody understand this? So in reality, fil waqi', he kam salla?
Four.
Arba rak'at. Everybody understand? He thinks that he made?
Three.
So the man, he said, the Prophet told him to do what? To build upon yaqeen. So in actuality, he made how many rak'at now?
Actually made four, but he
took three. How many? Count them. Three. But he actually made what?
Four.
Then he made a what?
Fifth.
An additional. He says, فَإِنْ صَلَّ خَمْسًا شَفَعْنَا لَهُ صَلَاتَهُ. If he made five, then what happens now? طيب. المهم. Moving forward. He says, when كان صلى إتماما لأربع, but if he only actually made four, كان ترغيما للشيطان, then at least he stifled shaitan. He left his salah and he didn't allow the shaitan to have nothing against him. In other words, we're not getting into the specifics of the what? What are we not getting into right now, Umar? We're talking about salah.
Acceptance or not?
La. What are we not getting into yet? He fell into the trap, John. Go right into the trap. We're not getting into the what? The specifics of sujood as-Sahu. This chapter is only dealing with what? The ruling of making? Ayyuh. How? Forget. Extra. Less. That's another chapter. We're not getting into those things yet. Right now we're using this hadith for how many purposes? And what's that purpose? What is the ruling? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he told the man to do what? To do something. When you have doubt, fix. Yabni. Yatra. Everybody understand this? That is the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That's us establishing the what? Ascent. Is sujood as-sahu wajib or not? When do you make the two? How many? You doubtful? Those are all details which what? Come after. Everybody got this? Right. Moving forward. This hadith as well is in Sahih Muslim. The author rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, or Hafidullah, he says, هَذِهِ النُّصُوصُ وَغَيْرُهَا تدل دلالة صريحة على أن الإمام أو المنفرد إذا سهى في الصلاة فزاد فيها أو نقص أو شك وجب عليه أن يأتي بسجدة السهو كما أنها توضح أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يترك سجدة السهو بل كان يحافظ عليها إذا سهى في الصلاة وهو المشرع القائل في سنته صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي فدل كل ذلك على وجوب سجدة السهو إذا حصل سببها وهو الزيادة أو النقص أو الشك. The author, he says, these five hadiths وغيرها and others, they prove clearly, he says, دلالة صريحة, is that both people, the imam and he who is offering the salah by himself, whenever they forget in the salah, be doing something extra, doing something less, or doubt, then they must do sujood as-sahu. He says these five hadiths, they also prove, is that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam never ever left off sujood as-sahu, never. Rather, it was something that whenever he forgot, whenever he made a mistake in the salah, he would do. And he is the one alayhi salatu wasalam who says, pray like you see me praying. Pray like you see me praying. He then says, it also proves, these five hadiths also prove, is that whenever a person forgets and he does a reason behind sujood as-sahu, then he must perform it. And those reasons are three: ziyada, naqs, or shak. Addition, omission, or doubt. Everybody clear on this? So therefore, this is a very important way of studying now. And that is, for a person to take the ahadith, to gather them first and foremost. Gather the hadith. Gather them. Put them in one place. Five hadiths, different places, what? Put them in one makan. Authenticate them. They're all sahiha. Then break them down and dissect them critically. These hadiths, to summarize them, prove the what? Following points. Number one, kada. Number two, kada. Number three, kada. Everybody got this? This is a very beneficial way of studying any issue of the deen. You want to learn about the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Does iman increase or decrease? Is there such thing called qadr? Is the Quran the kalam of Allah? Are the sahaba in Jannah or in the fire? Any issue of aqidah, gather the text, put them in one place, and then do what? Analyze them, break them down. The first hadith proves kada. The second hadith proves kada. The three hadiths collectively prove so on and so. Everybody understand this? This is how you study. Gather the information, put it in one place, look at it, break it down, and do what? Critically what? Analyze it. Tahleel al-Nusus. You analyze the text and you break it down. So the author mentioned how many hadith source, how many proofs? Five. Five texts. All of them are authentic. All of them are authentic. So therefore, these hadiths, me knowing about them, me memorizing them, me hearing about them, is not necessarily enough. My next step, Umar, is to do what? Halilha. Is that what? Break them down in niqat, clear points. These hadiths prove that the Prophet ﷺ, such and such. They prove that the one behind the Prophet ﷺ, such and such. They prove the Prophet never ever left off. Everybody understand this? An example of this would be the sutra, for example. The sutra. Sutra, very controversial issue among many Muslims today. Do you have to pray with something in front of you? An object called a sutra? Or can you just pray in the middle of the musalla with nothing in front of you? What will be the first step? To see what a madhab said? See what Sheikh Fulan said? To see this? The first thing is to gather the what? All the hadith on the sutra. Bukhari, Muslim, Ahmed, Muwatta, put them in one place. And then break them down. The first hadith or the first two hadiths show that the Prophet physically used a sutra. He didn't address the people. Lam yukhatib. He didn't tell people that, but he did it himself. So we've excluded the option of those who say the sutra is not from the deen. Sutra is idol worship, somebody may say. To put something in front of you, you're worshiping that thing. So don't do that. We're done with that code, whoever said it. Number two, third hadith, or hadith number three, four, and five, they also prove that the Prophet ﷺ never left off the sutra. Hajj, home, Mecca, Medina, wherever he was, he always had a what? Sutra. Hadith number 6, 7, 8 prove that the Prophet ﷺ commanded. Hadith 9 proves that the Prophet ﷺ ran and almost touched the wall, pushed the thing from running in front of him. Or hakada. Or any issue that you want to deal with. It's to take the nusus, take the text, and then do what? Take ma yustafadu min kalam Allah wa kalam Rasulullah alayhi wasallam. That which is benefited from Allah's speech and from the speech of his messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. The author, he then says, قال ابن رشد في بداية المجتهد اختلفوا في سجود السهو هل هو فرض أو سنة فذهب الشافعي إلى أنه سنة وذهب أبو حنيفة إلى أنه فرض لكن ليس من شروط صحة الصلاة وفرق مالك بين السجود للسهو في الأفعال وبين السجود للسهو في الأقوال وبين الزيادة والنقصان فقال سجود السهو الذي يكون الأفعال الناقصة واجب وعنده من شروط صحة الصلاة وعنه أن سجود السهو للنقصان واجب وسجود الزيادة مندوب وقال النووي في المجموع سجدة ليست بواجبة وإنما هي سنة خلافا لأبي حنيفة حيث قال بوجوبها مع تسليم أن الصلاة لا تبطل بتركها وعن مالك أنه إن كان السهو لنقصان يجب السجود ويروى عن أحمد وأصحابه الوجوب مطلقا وقال الشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية في هذا إجاب السجود لكل ما يترك مما أمر به إذا تركه سهيا ولم يكن تركه سهيا موجبا لإعادته بنفسه وإذا زاد ما نهى عنه ساهيا فعلى هذا كل مأمور به في الصلاة إذا تركه ساهيا فإما أن يعيده إذا ذكره وإما أن يسجد للسهو لا بد من أحدهما وهذا يقتضي مداومته صلى الله عليه وسلم عليها وتوكيدها وأنه لم يدعها في السهو المقتضي لهما فقط وهذه دلائل بينة واضحة على وجوبهما وهو قول جمهور العلماء ومذهب مالك وأحمد وأبي حنيفة وليس مع من لم يجبهما حجة تقارب ذلك انتهى كلام شيخ الإسلام. The author he then says, Ibn Rushd, a Maliki scholar, he said in his famous book, Bidayatul Mujtahid, he says, اختلفوا في سجود السهو. They, the ulama, the classical traditional scholars, they differ on the ruling of sujood السهو. هل هو فرض أو سنة? Is it mandatory? Or is it something that's preferable? He says, Imam al-Shafi'i, he held the view that it was only preferable. It's not mandatory. It's not fard. And Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he had the view that it's fard, it's mandatory. However, it isn't something that's from the shurut, the prerequisites of the salah. It isn't something which will nullify the salah if you leave it off. He then says, number three, Imam Malik rahimahullah, he took the middle course, supposedly. He said that if a person leaves off an act, it's not the same as him leaving off a statement. If a person does something extra, it's not the same as a person taking from the salah. He says here, the sujood with regards to the actions of the prayer is mandatory to the end of his speech. He then says, he quotes Imam An-Nawi rahimahullah saying that it's not wajib. He held the view of his Imam Shafi'i, khilafan li Abi Hanifa. And Abu Hanifa rahimahullah held the view that it's mandatory, as we previously said. Moving forward, he then quotes Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah by saying, listen carefully to these words. He says, "Fi hadha ijabu sujood li kulli ma yutrak mimma amara aw umira bihi idha tarakahu sahyan." He says, "Fi hadha," mentioning some hadiths, "is ijab." Is the Prophet ﷺ clearly addressing the people, telling the people, "Do it. Do not leave it off. Do not leave the salah unless you have done something." He says, "For anything that a person leaves off forgetfully." I understand this. So if a person intentionally leaves off something from the salah, then it has nothing to do with our discussion, our class. A person who leaves off something, who does something extra, based off of what? Forgetfulness. That's it. Sahu. Forgetfulness. Nothing more. He says here, the Prophet ﷺ clearly did it all of the time. It's something that he didn't leave off. And it proves is that the Messenger of Allah ﷺ made it mandatory. He says, and this is the view of most of the ulama. The madhab of Malik, he doesn't mention the details of Imam Malik, and the madhab of Imam Ahmad, and also Abu Hanifa. He says, and those who say that it isn't mandatory, he says, then they don't necessarily have a strong argument. They don't necessarily have a strong argument. So the summary, al-talkhis. The summary is, number one, sujood as-sahu is what? Among the ulama is what? No. Aywa, it's khilaf among the ulama. That's the first point. Number two, the ahadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, his actions, his statements, clearly prove that the view that states that it's wajib is what? Hadha huwa. There's no doubt about that. Everybody understand it? And those who say that it isn't mandatory, the reasons why, that's their reasons. That's their reasoning. That's the ijtihadat. Af'al, aqwan, naqs, nuqsan, shurut as-salah. That's all determining things in front of the clear text. So therefore, if you make sujood as-sahu, and you feel that it's mandatory, that's what you should do. If someone asks you, you should do what? You should tell them that. Your children, you teach them that. Your wife asks you, you teach her that. Your husband asks you, you teach him that. As far as you forcing, abusing, berating, and dragging someone across the masjid to do it, what? No, you cannot do that. Why not? Because they may come from a country in which there's a specific madhab that they've been taught that it isn't mandatory. You cannot force the next person to do something which the ulama of Islam differed over. Have I got this? You yourself, that's your madhab. I believe that it's mandatory. If I'm the imam of the salah, I'm going to do it. If someone asks me, I'm going to what? I'm going to tell them that. I'm not going to make inkar and force and speak down upon the next person for not making the sujood as-sahu if they only believe that it's what? Recommended. Right, moving forward. The author, rahimahullah, hafidhullah, says, Al-hikmatu min mashru'iyati sujood as-sahu. من محاسن شريعة الإسلام شرعية سجود السهو لأن المسلم مطالب بأن يؤدي الصلاة وهي أعظم أركان الإسلام بعد الشهادتين على الوجه الصحيح السالم من الأخطاء ولأن لا يفوت المسلم الأجر العظيم المترتب على أداء الصلاة فقد شرعت سجدة السهو لتجبير أو لتجبر ما قد يحصل على المسلم من سهو في صلاته سواء هذا خطأ هناك مكتوب سوء سواء أزيادة كان هذا السهو أو زيادة كان السهو أم نقصا أم شكا وذلك من تمام فضل الله ومنته على عباده لئلا تضيق عليهم الأمور ويشعروا بالحرج وما جعل علينا في ديننا من حرج والحمد لله. He says, from the beauties of Islam, from the beauties of this deen is سجدة السهو, is the sujood of sahu being a part of the religion. And that is because the Muslim has been requested The Muslim has been ordered, the Muslim has been addressed to perform the salah in the perfect manner. Allah, His Messenger, they have spoken to you and they've requested you as a slave not just to make the salah, but to make the salah what? He says, in a perfect manner. In a manner that is intended by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How much do we need this as Muslims? Speaking to myself and us here in this masjid. How many of us make salah? How many people made salat al-Maghrib? The masjid was full of people. Walillahi alhamd. If we stopped and looked at our salah, starting with myself, with you, how many of us made salat perfectly? How many of us made salat the closest way to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That's a whole different story. If we remove the people that made the salah incorrectly, the masjid would be very, very empty, unfortunately. And it's no excuse, as we previously explained in the last class. It's no excuse. Because it's basic, simple knowledge that every Muslim has access to. But I don't care. I'm too busy. It doesn't matter. We saw, unfortunately, as we see, unfortunately, every week, people that come out of one door, talking, laughing, as we speak. While the knowledge is being what? On a plate, for free. So Yawm al-Qiyamah, you come, you stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's no excuse. You can't say, I didn't know Allah, I didn't know I was making salat wrong. No. So this is serious. So therefore, moving forward, he says here, the Muslim is requested to make the salah in the perfect manner. The salah, which is the greatest of the pillars of Islam after the shahadatain. Rather, a person could say that initially, the shahadatain are the greatest pillars of Islam, initially. But on a daily basis, the thing that you do every single day is what?
Salah.
There's no doubt about that. He says, and another reason why the sujood as-Sahu is legislated is for the Muslim not to lose out on the tremendous reward of performing a salah. The tremendous reward. Regardless whether he does something extra, something less, or has doubt. And there's no hardship upon us in our religion. And if we didn't have sujood as-Sahu, then it would be a clear hardship. And that's because you're stuck between two rocks, a rock and a hard place. The first rock or hard place, or first rock is what? Is that Allah told you to do what? No.
Perfect man.
Make the salat in the perfect manner. That's the first responsibility. And the hard place is that you're a human being. And we mentioned this in a class as well. The first class is that the nature of the human being is to do what? Forget. Let alone in 2017, stress, worry, drama, this one, bills, traveling, work, wife, kids, TV, sports, so many things in your head. So it's even more distraction and less mental focus. So if there was no sujood as-Sahu, you would be what? You'd be sandwiched. You'd be punished for not making salat correctly, even though it's my nature to, occasionally, from time to time. So the sujood as-Sahu is the way out of the rock in the hard place. It's the ease, it's the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one, for you not to be punished, for you not to be questioned. Number two, for you to be a human being, deficient, lacking, and still reap, wa alaykum as-salam to Allah, still reap the what? The full reward. Everybody understand? And still reap the what? The full reward. See how much sense it makes? The salah is to be made what? Perfectly. You as a human being are? Imperfect. But Allah will still give you and not be punished. This is the hikmah of what? Sujood as-Sahu. Because no matter whether you do it once, twice, a little or a lot, at one point in time in your life, you're going to forget something. Because he who was better than you, he what? He forgot. Everybody understand this beauty here? Everybody got this or not? And this is very important. It's something that we've explained in many classes, is that when you study fiqh, it shouldn't just be sathi. It shouldn't just be on the surface, on the roof. But the fiqh has to be connected to the spirituality as well. Why learn about wudu? Why learn about hijab? Why? What's so important about learning the correct and the proper ways? Because once you start studying fiqh and all the different technicalities, you become lost. And your heart may become hard. You just all day, every day, khilaf, ikhtalafu, this one, that one, qareena, qara'in, this technical term, this complexity. And you forget about the what? The actual spirituality. This is the purpose of all of this learning and studying in Arabic, and these words is what? It's Jannah. And getting away from the hellfire. And oftentimes we as people, we forget about this all of the time. We get caught up in this and that and fulan and fulana. And we actually forget about the nature of Islam. That this is only made for what? Ibadah. Everybody clear on this? Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, he went through all of that he went through, beaten, locked up, whipped, this and that, for one purpose, spirituality. That's it. Not for nothing else. Everybody got this? The Salaf al-Salih, they did what they did, they said what they said, they performed what they performed for the purpose of what? Spirituality. It was ibadah. That's why Ahlul Hadith traveled from one country to the next and suffered and sacrificed for no other reason besides what? Spirituality. So if you're a student of knowledge, if you're not focused on your spirit and your soul, something is very wrong. These technical terms are nothing more than a bridge, getting you closer to what Allah wants from you and what the Messenger of Allah wanted from you. So therefore, this is the wisdom of Sujood as-Sahu. He then says, يقول العلامة ابن القيم رحمه الله ثبت عنه صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال إنما أنا بشر مثلكم أنسى كما تنسون فإذا نسيت فذكروني وكان سهوه في الصلاة من تمام نعمة الله على أمته وكمال دينهم ليقتدوا به فيما يشرع أو يشرعه لهم عند السهو وهذا معنى الحديث المنقطع الذي في الموطأ إني لأنسى أو لأنسى لأسن وكان صلى الله عليه وسلم ينسى فيترتب على سهوه أحكام شرعية تجري على سهو أمته إلى يوم القيامة. He then says, Ibn al-Qayyim says, listen carefully to these words. It has been authentically reported that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I'm nothing more than a human being like you. إنما أنا بشر مثلكم. I'm a human being like you are a human being. I'm a man like you're a man. أنسى كما تنسونا. He says, I forget just like you forget. He says, فَإِذَا نَسِيتُ فَذَكِّرُونِي. And when I forget, please remind me. When I forget, please remind me. Ibn Qayyim, he says, when the Prophet ﷺ forgot in the Salah, it was from the greatest of Allah's blessings upon us as Muslims. It was a tremendous ni'mah, a perfect ni'mah, a perfected ni'mah that Allah decreed and made His Prophet forget. He made His Prophet forget. He says, it is a means of their religion being, he says, ikmali dinihim, finishing the religion, completing the religion. Liyaqtadu bihi, for them to follow his example and that which he legislated for them. Everybody understand this? Muhammad, he forgot for wisdom. For us to realize that don't kill yourself if you forget. And how to fix something that's based off of your what? Your human what? Nature. To forget. Everybody understand this? If Muhammad did not forget, and it wasn't legislated, then there would be the hardship. There'd be the haraj. There'd be the hardship. He then says, and this here, listen carefully. He says, and this is the meaning of the hadith, al-munqati. This hadith is isnad, is not the strongest. It's collected by Imam Malik in his muwatta' that says, inni la'ansa aw unassa. He says that I forget, or I'm caused to forget, li'usanna. For me to make a sunnah. I forget something to make a rule. I'm caused to forget something to do what? To teach. Everybody understand this? Ibn Qayyim then says, when the Prophet ﷺ forgot, he used to forget, there were all different rulings that pertain to his forgetfulness. And these rulings will be applied upon his followers to the day of judgment. So just look at the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the sihr was placed upon the Prophet ﷺ, how could sihr be on the Prophet? Allah didn't protect Muhammad. Muhammad didn't make adhkar. He didn't receive the Quran. How could sihr fall on him? If it fell on him, then it can fall on any of us. So what's the purpose of me making the adhkar and so on and so on and so on? How could Allah allow this to happen? His messenger, his prophet, be put under a magic spell, sorcery. But look what happened when that spell was placed on him. There's a list of what? Rulings and lessons that come from it. What to do, how to say, what to destroy, what to read, what to recite, and the list goes on. So it's tremendous wisdom. And you can never ever lose focus on the reality of studying fiqh in this light. This light is that it has to be based off of wisdom and spirituality. There's hikmah in using a sutra. There's hikmah in you dressing like this or wearing this or praying like that. And it's not just on the surface as many of us think it is. Oh, that's the sunnah, you have to do it. That's mandatory. No, it's wisdom behind it. And that wisdom is you getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khairan inshallah, that's the end of that chapter. We're going to stop here with regards to that tonight. The next chapter, which we'll mention perhaps the next week, It says, Sifatu sujood as-Sahu, hal yukabbiru li sajdati as-Sahu. He now goes into the description of sujood as-Sahu. The description. Do you make takbir or do you make the movement without a takbir? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala surely knows best.